Am I live now? I'm not sure if I'm live now. I press go live again here. Let me know in the chat. Sorry, I just went through the whole beginning episode of this, and every time I press go live, it doesn't go. I'm sure if it is. So I am live. Okay. Thanks, babe. Okay. Anyways, let's start this over again. So today is day 4 of a 7-day bathroom remodel, and I'm really excited to show you this specific day because it's going to go into a whole bunch of things with tile setting. And tile setting is one of my favorite things. The day goes so fast when I could go there. Hey, Troy, thanks so much. Thanks for coming in on this live stream. Appreciate it, man. You've been doing some tremendous work on your own bathroom. It's really tremendous to see. So I'm really hoping you're going to get into the tile work. I do think that this episode will help you out in a lot of ways. I'm sure you've probably already seen some of my stuff on social media that kind of goes over some of the highlights of what we're going to get into. But, you know, really, tile setting should be the fun part. This is the part where we're just, you know, we're going to be just making the nice part of the bathroom. This is what everyone's excited about. This is what makes a bathroom look really tremendous. So, and, hey, on the way in, if you could, give me a like if you could. That really helps out the algorithm. If you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, please subscribe. It doesn't cost anything. All you need is a Google account. Press subscribe, and you'll get notified when these live streams come out. You have to hit that notification bell, though. When you subscribe, there's a little bell next to it. If you hit that, that'll make sure that you get these out. I try to get this stuff, give you a notice a couple of hours ahead of time. But it really, you know, I'm working on this course, so that's what this is all about. And, you know, I'm working all day trying to get all the components together, and then I want to do a live stream to express and show what's going on. So you can actually watch this entire course online if you go to my YouTube channel. Let me get myself a little bit smaller here, and we'll start getting into the demonstration. But basically, if you go to my YouTube channel and you go to playlists up here, so you press on playlist, and it'll be a whole area here that says bathroom remodeling online course. And in there, I have all of the course, basically. So I really wanted to just make this interactive. So really, if you're in the chat and you have a question, leave it here in the comments. I'll pause the video. We'll go over some of the points. Try to keep it specific to the project they're working on. And then later on in the stream, we can go into whatever it is that you want. But, you know, really part of the reason I'm doing these live streams as well is if I get common questions from you all, maybe some of you have already been rolled into my course and you have questions about it. Basically, I just wanted to make this the best course that I can and basically solve all of the questions that people might have or anxieties they have about bathroom remodeling. If you don't know me, my name is Steve. I've been a contractor in the Pittsburgh area for 22 years now. 2022. I started when I was 21. I started my own business year 2000. So it's pretty simple to add up the math on that. But the last 14 years, I've been doing nothing but bathroom remodeling. And I really still have to actually go through my folders of stuff to figure out how many bathrooms I've actually done. But it's close to 100 at this point. But really, it doesn't really matter. I mean, you know, it just these last few years, I've kind of honed down on a certain pattern of how to go about bathroom remodeling. And I really just want to pass this knowledge on to you. And then obviously, you know, I'm selling a course here and I'm hoping to, you know, that some of this knowledge could be valuable and make another business out of it. And I'm not having to be on my knees every day doing this stuff. But hey, if you're, you know, I really want to express this is that if you do your own bathroom remodel, it is something that you will really will reward you for years to come. You know, I know that there's nothing worse than getting into a dingy, moldy bathroom and you know, it's just not a great way to start out a good day. So, you know, having a new bathroom is going to be worth every penny that you put into it. And I'm hoping I can save you a lot of money by teaching you how to do this yourself. So let's just get right into it. If you've already seen previous videos, you might want to just come back here in about 10 minutes because I'm going to go over a recap over the entire process up to this point. So again, this is a 7-day bathroom remodel. And basically it's, you know, it's day by day. I did it in real time and I'm just showing you exactly the process that I find to be the most efficient way to get in and out and finish that project. So basically it's a full bathroom, 5x8, pretty standard size, got a tub, got a vanity, got a toilet. But the big thing is that we gutted everything down. So we'll just get straight into the recap here. Let me shrink myself so that this doesn't get in the way of the video. So let me pause here and get this ready to go. There is no sound on the video, just so you know. I'm just going to be kind of narrating over it, going over what we did. So let me shrink myself down into here. Okay, so this is basically what the bathroom. I'm going to do a little bit of a preview of what the bathroom looked like. Maybe you can, recognize a similar situation with your own. But again, I really wanted to start out doing courses with, you know, the most basic common size bathroom. And that really is, 5 foot wide by 8 foot or so. So let's get right into it. So this was the old 1970. This home was built in 1970 and it was a split entry home. So it's a very common location. There was no window in this. This was in the main, this is like the main bathroom of the home off the hallway. It had a steel tub, 4x4 tile. So first thing you want to do is just get that toilet out of there, get the vanity out of there. This gives you more space so you can actually bring your tools in. But for me, it's more or less, I want to start videoing. So I go over the demonstration of replacing these valves. The one thing you really want to do, though, is you want to make sure you shut off this water before you get into that demo process. You don't want to be messing around with this stuff. All those valves are usually bad and you can't turn them off. But we get into the drain assembly. You want to try to take this apart so that you're not getting a whole bunch of debris in your existing pipes. Sometimes that doesn't work out. In this specific situation, I was not able to remove that tub drain. So we're going to the next best thing, which is cutting it with a Sawzall and removing that tail piece. Now we move right on to the tub surround. Again, the water, I did get turned back on at this point because I put caps on, and this is about being prepared for things and making sure that you have, caps like that so you can get the water back in your home. Then you go ahead and remove the tub and put a temporary light fixture in. That's gonna be helpful if you don't have a window. And I really am a big, strong believer of just tearing everything out of the bathroom and starting from new. So getting rid of all that drywall, especially if it's has wallpaper like this on it, that's really gonna be difficult for you to finish. And really the process of installing bathrooms really requires, or doesn't require, but it really is helpful when everything is taken out of the room. And you don't want to be spending thousands of dollars over top of bad plumbing or bad electrical work. You want to see what's going on there. And like I said, it's going to make things a lot easier if you remove everything and start. And really, I mean, drywalling is not that expensive or that difficult. And I'm going to go through a lot of that stuff in this course on how to go about this. I always remove the ceiling as well. Obviously, getting rid of that existing vent fan. Most of those are useless. My favorite is the whisper line vent fans, and you want to install that. This is the first day here. For reference, this is where I really like to get all the demo, get that vent in, get anything prepped for a light. I like to have my lights separated from the fan. And then I like to get that drywall up that first day as well. That just kind of gives a little bit more ease of the anxiousness of a client, and really it gives you a little bit more peace of mind the next morning. So the next day, this is day two. First thing is remove your existing trap. I do recommend you always replace whatever trap it is, even if it is plastic or ABS or PVC, because those traps can be clogged and hard to snake out once they've been in there for a long time. But you want to adapt all your plumbing. Now, I want to just pause here for a second. Day two can be something that really is going to take a lot more of your time. You might not know exactly what you're getting into. And most of the time, that's a question mark for me too. I have no idea. You can get through the access panel and check out some of the plumbing that you have, but you really have no real indication of what things look like until you remove out all the existing stuff. So plumbing is always something that might draw out a little bit more time to do. But in this scenario, this was a fairly simple, straightforward process. It had copper that was in good condition. My recommendation is that, copper can definitely still be good and last, definitely decades from now as well. But if it's cast iron, you want to pay attention to see how corroded it is, what it looks like in the inside of the pipe. If it looks like it's really kind of rusting all the way through, you want to replace it. So these are the things that you really don't know until you start getting into the project of what you're really working with. And this is where I always, try to advise my, the clients that I'm working for that this might be an area that there's additional cost to refinangle thing or cut out different parts that are bad. But anyways, I'm just adapting here with the Fernco. And hey, when you're watching any of my videos on plumbing, electrical, all that stuff, this is just basically expressing the way that I go about it. Always consult your own building code requirements. You know, obviously every state is different. They have different rules. So I'm not speaking uniformly all the way around the country or the world for that matter. So just take this as not financial advice, basically, and that this is just kind of a demonstration of how I go about it. So you get that Fernco set up before you set the tub. That's going to make it easier to attach rather than crawling underneath that tub and trying to do anything. And then you put some new subfloor down if you have it, if you have to. In this instance, we needed to put some new 3/4 inch to level it out. And then I like to put my drain assemblies in before I even set the tub. This is going to make it a lot easier for you if you're by yourself. You definitely, it's tough to do a tub of drain assembly when it's already in place. So doing it before you set it really makes it easy. And then, I'm a big fan of silicone and making sure that everything's leak free. So this is, a method that I use to make sure that everything stays in good condition. So, and then the thing about dry fitting tubs is that you typically are dry fitting it 3 to 4 times every time that you, when you're doing a bathroom remodel. It's tough to find out where that ledger board is supposed to be. But anyways, moving on to the plumbing, you want to address that plumbing, make sure that it's all ready to go for the tub when you set it in place. Now, I usually do just get the trap arm in place. Let me just rewind that for a second. So I like to get my trap arm in where the 90 degree elbow goes down. So then all I have to do is take that P-trap and slide it, glue it and slide it onto the drain assembly. That'll make it a lot easier if you have at least this part connected. But I always like using solvent weld P-traps as well. So when you're gluing everything together, you have a solid connection and it'll last, as long as that bathroom lasts pretty much. So we move on to that and then setting the tub. Again, if you remove everything out of your bathroom, it's going to make the tub installation a lot easier. Trying to fit a tub when there's already existing walls in place is very frustrating and aggravating to do. So be sure you, just take my advice, please, and remove, most of your drywall. It's going to be better, especially if you're getting into a full renovation like this. Then you want to put your ledger board down. You always have to pay attention to your tub manufacturer and how they want the tub secured. And they're not all the same. In this one, we were using washers and screws to do it. But then here, after I get the tub installed, this is where I slide that P-trap into place. So very kind of simple. And then you move on to the actual shower and tub faucet. This is one of the easiest ways that I have found to do it, and that is converting everything to PEX. In this course, I have some really good recommendations that will make this even easier for you and could even eliminate you from having to do soldering or any of that. So be sure to check out in the course or check out the live videos previous to this. It'll go into a lot of that detail. So you want to test and fill the tub. Always double check that overflow, very important. And then moving on to the framing. So this portion right here, so that was day one, getting the tub and shower faucet in, getting the tub in and testing everything. This is day three, getting into the framing, blocking and shimming. And shimming I mean by making it so that you can get your backer board to overhang that tub surround, or overhang the tub lip, I should say. But framing and blocking is really important. This is you spending the extra time at this moment right here is going to make the rest of the process of the bathroom a lot easier. So, we'll get into it, but basically making sure that all of your studs are in line with one another, that will make tiling a lot easier if you have a flat, nice wall. And really, my rule of thumb is basically 1/4 inch. If you're within 1/4 inch of level or plumbness, that's good enough. You can overcome things very easily with that. When it gets beyond that, that's when you want to kind of address that floor or address that wall, and there's multiple ways of going about making sure the wall is flush with one another. And you can plane down a stud, you can add a shim, or you can actually just sister on a new stud and make that come out to the level that you want it. So I go over detail instruction on this whole scenario here, but make sure you put nail plates, you you know, most likely you'll hit those areas if you don't have nail plates. But basically what I'm doing is just using strips of plywood and going over it. So in this one, it was a 1/4 inch and 1/2 inch. So 1/2 inch on this back wall because the tub space was not 60 inches exactly. Most of the time you're going to find that when you rip out your existing stuff, it's usually, 60.5 inches, 61 inches, somewhere in between there. If you have a plaster bathroom, actually one of the members in my course right now, had mud walls with tile. So she was going to be leaving the existing cast iron tub, and they were almost an inch away from, I'm assuming that. She said it was really far away from the tub lip, and she had to shim everything out. So my guess is she might even be using 2x4s flatways and shimming it out. But whatever it takes, you do it. I mean, typically, I always grab 1/4 inch plywood and 1/2 inch plywood, and I always have that on my truck or in my trailer the day of this because... there's nothing worse. That's one of the things too about this course. I'm trying to prepare you before you get started so that you're not running out to the store every day. If you run to Home Depot or Lowe's every single day, you're most likely not going to get this in a timely fashion. You're not going to get it done in 7 days. So having different variety sheets of plywood that, you know, you can return if you don't use them. But most of the time I just need 1/4 inch and then 1/2 inch. And that usually does the job. You could always double up, you know, either one to get the 3/4 or, you know, 1 inch for that matter. So, but in this scenario, I wanted to make sure, okay, I just should mention this as well. This tub, I wanted to make sure it was tight to the plumbing wall because I had a door on this wall and you don't want to be putting extension jams on the door side. So if I would have shimmed out this whole wall, it would have brought it out past my jam on my door and required some kind of extension jam for my trim. You don't want to do that because when you close the door will always have paint missing off of that extension jam. Basically the latch of the door will always hit it. So you always want, when you do extension jams on doors, you always want to do it on the outside of the door, not on the inside. But anyways, this was just the easiest way to solve that. And that was make sure that the tub was tucked up against that plumbing wall. So this is blocking for your towel bars and accessories. And then you move on to drywalling. So this is typically, I like to get all my drywall hung before lunch on that third day. And then right after that, after lunch, basically moving into doing that first coat of drywall mud. So I have a lot of great tips in here. This, unfortunately, just takes practice. This is a good time to practice is that roughens, you know, the first coat makes it, you get a little bit used to the tools, but it's really hard to tell you exactly the technique. I do try to give you good advice on going about that, but make sure you clean that bucket. That really is important. So, and then moving on. So that's usually drywall mudding is before lunch. Now, I don't really expect everyone to be able to do a bathroom in 7 days. This takes a lot of experience to get this quick. And obviously, I'm a contractor, so I have a trailer full of extra parts and everything. But my hope is that this course will provide you. Enough guidance to get a lot of the stuff together so that you're not running out to those stores every day. But at the end of day three, you want to go over your towel layout. You want that starting to go through your mind. I don't want you staying up all night thinking about it, but you need to get that brain working and thinking about your towel layout. This is important here because of the recessed niche that I'm putting in here. So I needed to know kind of where my tile layer was going to be so that I can make sure that there isn't any slivers around the niche. So it's important to take a little bit of time on this, but don't take too much time at this point. You'll be able to adjust your tile layer the following day on day four when you're getting into actually tiling, but at least, you know, getting a good reference point of where it might be. And then you can always make the niche bigger and then build up thin set or whatever it takes to meet your tile work. It's just harder to, you know, stretch the niche to larger point. So I always recommend try to make your niches an inch, 2 inches bigger than what you actually need them, because then you can address it with the tile work and make it smaller then. So this is just me cutting it out. I like to put these corner niches in these tub surrounds. I think they're a great location for it. Kind of hides everything. And most of the time you don't have too many products, but you know, this is just one solution. Then moving right into the waterproofing. So this is a very important step. This is a really decently long process in my course because I want to make sure that you're doing this correctly. But this is one of the easiest systems that I have found over the years, and it's very affordable too. You know, it's about $25 a sheet, and then the sealant, you're basically, or that's how you're waterproofing all the seams and the screw holes that you're using, and you can just use a utility knife to cut everything. So really easy, a lot less work than cement board. And remember guys, cement board and hardy backer are not waterproof. Those things need to be waterproofed, you know, before tiling. So, you know, cement board could be cheaper than this, but then by the time you waterproof it, it's taking up time and whatnot. So then we make a custom niche out of it. So the excess pieces that we have, you could just make your own custom niche with it. Just takes a little bit more work, you know, with the sealant. I would definitely recommend getting additional tubes of sealant for a recessed niche, because you'll see here I use a lot of it to basically address the entire area. And this is an important spot because water is obviously going to be hitting you and going into that niche, and you need to make sure that it's waterproof. And in there, I'm just demonstrating, making sure that is pitching towards the tub, because you don't want water sitting in that niche. And then you just basically do your final coat of sealant over everything. The rule of thumb on that is 1-inch overlap on all of your screws and seams. That's usually not an issue if you're using a 4-inch knife. Very simple to use. So just, you know, as long as you don't run out, you'll be good to go here on the third day. You know, it's really easy to run out of the ceiling, especially when you're getting into those custom niches. And you'll see here, I needed on the wall with the door, I needed to fill the tub gap. So that's going to take up a whole tube in itself. There's no problem with using that sealant to fill that tub gap. It just takes a lot of it. That's all. And then always bring that waterproofing down along the side of the tub too. That's a real common area for things to get deteriorated. So I always like to use the go board going down the side of the tub as well. And then for extra insurance, you can go ahead and put a valve seal on. I use some Curdy Fix for this. This is a Schluter product, so I use their products to actually adhere it. Curdy Fix is just another type of sealant for that. And then as you saw, I had the Curdy band for my, let me see where that's at. So right there, you could see on the drywall transition, I had Curdy band going over top of the drywall and all the way down along the side of the tub. So anything that's sticking outside of that tile work, you can just drywall mud over and finish with paint. So I always like to have my waterproofing completely, you know, basically coming outside of that tub area and then addressing that later on. So that's the recap. That was all the way up to the end of day 3, and we're going to get right into day 4. So again, here's my course. When you go to bathroomremodeling.teachable.com, so up here you can see bathroomremodeling.teachable.com. Right now I only have 2 courses available. I have a custom glass enclosure, so if you're doing custom glass for a custom shower, this is going to save you a fortune, because I know that glass enclosures are always really the last part of a bathroom remodel, and it usually costs quite a bit. You know, most 3x4 shower enclosures are close to $2,500 to $3,000. So I think this $60 value of teaching you how to go ahead and measure it, order it, and install it is going to save you quite a bit of money. I'll eventually do a live stream on that as well, getting into more detail. I have a bunch of other glass enclosures that I need to edit and put into this as well. But that's one thing I'm trying to do. I'm trying to improve on all of these courses, and your feedback is going to definitely help that. So right now I'm just selling this Taubman shower course for $25 because I don't have it finished. I'm kind of working on it as we're going. So what you see today is basically what I have done. And you know, these next few weeks, I'm hoping to have the course completed. But again, we're at day 4. This price will go up eventually. But right now I'm just really happy to see the amount of people that jumped in on it and, you know, are getting use out of it. So, you know, my hope is that it becomes just a great way to go about this. Rather than being on YouTube for hours and watching ads, you can go right in here and you'll see a lot of the links and stuff that I have in here that are going to be really helpful. So let me view this as a student. So if you're a student and you buy the courses, this is the way it'll look. You'll have two options or whatever options I have. Right now, these are the only two courses I have. But my plan is to build this out for all types of different, you know, curbless showers to the curb showers. I have pretty much four showers that I still need to edit. So there's four different scenarios that I'm really hoping to also make a course out of. Now most walk-in shower systems and stuff, you're not going to be able to do that in 7 days. That usually takes more time and labor to actually do, showers than versus a tub. But getting right into it, just so you know that, you know, basically it's an all-inclusive course. It's going through the demo process, just like we talked about, tub installation, shower faucet installation, hanging drywall. So you saw the recap. That's really most of it. But, you know, we get into a lot of this tile setting and the epoxy grouting. And what's really great is just the way it's set up. You can just go day by day, go, you know, I have certain key points, lectures, you can call them, on each section that goes through those main core parts of each project. So getting into day four, just click on that. And let me see if there's anybody else in the chat here. I don't know how you, there we go. CJ, yeah, when do I think I'll have the full package deal done? I'll probably have this done by the end of January is my hope. I'll also be, I need to get some checklists. A lot of my intros here are talking about these checklists, but I wanted to complete the core videos and the details first before I make that checklist. So my hope is by the end of January, but always, hey, you know, feel free to, you know, ask me a question about anything that you have. You know, again, that's just going to help out the course in itself. But let's just kind of take a look at the intro. This is, I always have an intro at the beginning of the day. This is about staying focused. So you really need to plan your days, make sure you get these core elements done so that you can get it done in an efficient time. There's so many things in bathroom remodeling that you can get wrapped up in and just take a lot more time trying to figure out. So for instance, electrical is always one of those things that, you know, you might be confused about where something goes, but I highly recommend you play around with that in between the stages of a lot of this stuff. So get that tub set, get that tub and shower faucet in, then go back to messing around with the electrical. My thoughts are, if you buy this course and you're somewhat mechanically inclined and you've done, I mean, I would imagine you're not going to try your own bathroom remodel if you haven't done other home projects, or at least I hope you don't. I would not start out with a bathroom model. I'd probably try to, you know, renovate your powder room. I mean, maybe you can do renovate a powder room or get into tiling your foyer or something like that. But, you know, most likely you're somewhat mechanically inclined. So my thoughts are is that you definitely will be able to get a functional bathroom by the end of the week. Now it might not be exactly where you want it. It might need painted. It might need, you know, more drywall work done, or hell, even at this point, this is one of the things I was going to say, day four, technically you can use this shower. You can go ahead and put in, the shower head and the shower valve, and the waterproofing's already up. So it is a functional shower. So if it's only one, if you only have one bathroom in your house, this can be a really, big pressure point. This is where those big companies that come in and say, we can do your bathroom in a day or two, that's where they thrive. Because, you know, when you only have one bathroom, you can't live without it, you know? So that's where these companies charge you tens of thousands of dollars to just put a bunch of plastic over top of your existing stuff. And at least it's not falling apart and moldy anymore. But I really encourage you not to go that route. I think if you've got everything down to the studs, you can really make sure that your bathroom's going to last for a very long time. I've actually ripped out a lot of those sleeve over tub systems. I've heard horror stories about them constantly cracking and having to get the company come back out and redo things. From my understanding, they do a good job of warranting it, but you know, who wants to have a problem after you spend all that money? You know, not too many people are going to want to deal with that. So anyways, really at day four in this course where I'm at right now, it is, you can actually just temporarily install your toilet again and have a functional bathroom and come back to it when you have more time. But my hope is that, you know, you'll be able to get a lot more accomplished in a week, but that really comes down to planning ahead and making sure that you have a lot of these items on hand versus running out every day and trying to get something. So here's just the initial intro to day four. Okay, so we're on day four. We're gonna get into the tiling here today. So my main objective today is to get the back wall of the shower done, possibly a side wall as well, and then the actual floor of the bathroom. So got a lot of work today, but it is gonna be a little bit more fun getting into the tile work and getting feeling like you're accomplishing something with the decorative tile. So again, it's all about staying focused and trying to get these core elements done. And that's why this breakdown, I think, can help you out a lot. So, you know, like for instance, day three, you know, hang that drywall. If you don't get to the first coat of mud, it's not the end of the world. You'll be able to make up some of that later on. But if you try to get these core points done, you should be able to accomplish a lot and get things going. But each goal of the day, I always go through the reference point again visually of what you need to do. So today we're going to be putting down that D-Trim waterproofing. We're going to be putting that down on the floor and getting that all set up. We're going to go into tiling that back wall in the side wall of the shower. So this is really important to get moving here, because it's going to take time for this stuff to dry. And, you know, this can be kind of time consuming, obviously, getting into the tile work. But you want to move right into the tile work after that. You get your second coat of mud on here. That always takes time to dry, depending on your humidity level of where you live and everything. A second coat of drywall mud might take 2 days to dry. So I really encourage you to get that second coat on that on that fourth day, so that has time to dry, and then you have, the time to continue to address any imperfections that you have. And then getting into the tile layout of the floor, you don't necessarily have to install the floor right off the bat, but just to know, when you install Ditra, you can tile it immediately if you wanted to. But I always like to get a good idea of what my layout is going to be on day four for the tile, so that I can get set up and install that the next day. Next thing you also want to do at the end of the day, if you're doing any type of mosaic border, make it easy on yourself. Put it on a Schluter membrane. Put these mosaics on that, install it, or thin set them on this on the Curdy band, and then you can be able to just take that whole piece and set it in place of where your border is going to be. This is going to save a lot of time. You're not having to fool around with, you know, all the thin sets going to squeeze through all the joints. You're not, you know, a lot of these new mosaics too that are all glass, they're getting so thin. Some of them are, you know, probably a quarter inch thin, and they just kind of all fall apart and are really hard to put in. So if you put them on the floor like this, put them on some Curdy band, it'll make it a lot easier to install. And then I just have a whole bunch of a list of things that are going to be helpful for you as far as basically demonstrating all the tools and different things that I use. So I have a really long list. This list is actually going to get longer. I have a lot more things to add. But really, it's just my recommendations of the core tools to do a lot of this stuff. Some of them, you know, depending on the tile work that you're doing, you might not need them. But that's, you know, this is basically referencing what I did on this particular bathroom and what I've used. So getting right into the Schluter Ditra floor underlayment, let's first go into mixing thin set. So this is really important step of any membranes or any tile installation, but a really critical point about installing it for the Ditra membrane. It has to be loose. It has to be a very thin consistency. It's not going to be something that you're going to be setting tile with. It's something a lot looser than that, because you want to make sure that membrane is grabbing hold of that Ditra very well. And then when you're doing the membranes, you can have a very nice thin layer of that membrane over top of the areas, so you don't have a lot of buildup. That's one problem with some of the Schluter products, is you get buildup from the membranes, and, you know, having the right consistency for your thin set is really important. So let's watch this 1 minute video on mixing thin set. I do like to use the Schluter All Set. That is the product that is the modified thin set that Schluter approves for their products. I do find it to have a superior bond to their membranes. So I like to buy one bag of that just to set the Ditra. You could buy enough Schluter All Set to set all the tile if you wanted to. It's not a bad thin set. I just have some better recommendations that will make things easier for you. But for the membranes, definitely Schluter All Set is the way to go. Okay, so for the membranes, we just need a very loose consistency. So we're gonna be using Schluter All Set to set the membrane and the Ditra mat. So it's definitely time to get accurate with your thin set measurement. So I have a little scale here. 50 pounds is what that bag is.
Now, scale's not necessary, but
8.5 quarts per bag.
It is going to make it more accurate.
So we have 4.25 ounce or quarts of water, and then we're going to figure out, try to get a more accurate reading on what a half bag is.
And I'm only doing a half bag because that floor is not very big. You know, you're talking about 30 square feet, 5 by 6.
29.
So it would be a waste to mix that whole bag to that consistency.
25.
You know, you can even use your home scale, most likely, to determine that. So this is a very long mixing process. I'm not showing that whole mixing process. But, yeah, you'll have to let it sit for 10 minutes, and then you can go... moving on to, yeah, you want to let it sit for 10 minutes, mix in another 2 minutes. So there's a lot of mixing involved with the slew roll set, but if you do that, it'll last a long time.
So for the membranes, you can see how soupy this is.
Now, that is after really the first thin mix. So I'll have to be honest, that is a little loose, but that is perfectly fine. As long as your trowel can hold the ridges, that's all that matters. So if your trowel, when you're troweling this on the walls or on the floor, if it can hold a ridge and it's not going to like flatten out again or anything, then your consistency is good enough. Now this is a little loose, but you know, this needed the slack, meaning it needed to wait for 10 minutes and then I needed to remix it for 2 minutes. But after you add the initial amount of water, and this goes for any thin set. Once you initially add water to it and you mix it, do not add any more water to it after that point. That will weaken the bond. It's basically like adding water to paint. You don't add water to the paint because it just doesn't work. That's the same thing with this.
For the Dietra mat and in any membranes that you're installing. So it is a really loose consistency.
Okay, so that's just that's a really important concept here, because when I hear problems that people have with installing their Dietra mat, it's usually because their thin set is too thick and it just doesn't want to grab onto it. And if it's too thick too, you're not going to get a very flat floor out of it too. It's going to be harder to press the air or any of the thin set out of it. So moving on to the actual Dietra installation here, we'll go ahead and do this. Now, you know, keep in mind, now if you had more time on day three, you could actually install this Dietra. And technically, you know, if you're really behind on your schedule, this could wait till the following day, to day five, if you had to, because like I said, you can install the Dietra and then immediately install the tile. So depending on where you're at with your schedule, this might not be the first thing you want to do on day four, but I'm a contractor. I'm trying to get things done efficiently. So I wanted to get this down and move on. My hope was I was going to actually get the tile floor down on this day, but with the videoing and everything else, there just isn't enough time in the day. So.
Okay. So for the underlayment of our floor, we're going to install some Schluter Dietra mat. And so this is just that waffle cone bit. Basically what this is doing is isolating the plywood layer from your tile layer, because wood always expands and contracts. So this is gonna help prevent any cracking or any movement with the tile. Now this has its limitations as far as being an isolation membrane, preventing that cracking from isolating. So if you have something structural that's not right, you have to address that. This is just purely for the minor details of the plywood expanding and contracting. And what's really great about it, it's waterproof as well. So really no need to do cement board unless you're doing penny tile or smaller tile. There are limitations. You can only use 2x2 tile on a membrane like this. So 2 inches by 2 inches is the minimum sized. We're doing 12x24 tile, so we're totally within that. But I really like the aspect that it's waterproof. It makes a lot of sense to have it waterproof in the bathroom. So the first thing you want to do is just take a wet, damp sponge, wipe down your substrate, take any dust off of this. And what this does is prevents the thin set being for the plywood from wicking the moisture out of the thin set quickly, but it also obviously removes the dust, so any bond breakers, anything like that. So just take a damp sponge, wipe down the area that you're going to be setting it. Okay, and then you want to use
this is a DITRA trial. They make a trials just made for DITRA, but it's essentially a 3/16 inch by 3/16 inch square notch trowel. So you don't need a whole bunch of thin set underneath of this to set it, and but it really does help to have the proper amount.
So you might kind of be able to pour it out of the bucket like that.
And then use the flat side of the trowel, and this is what Tal said, is called burning the thin set into the substrate. So you're just taking the flat side of the trowel and making sure that everything is covered. And what this does, two things. It pretty much makes it easier to get nice ridges, but it also makes sure that this is bonding well to that substrate. You want to do directional troweling, so having all your ridges in the same direction.
Hey, Troy, thanks, man. $25 you ever spent, I appreciate that. That's the cost of this course, by the way. And 21 methods. Yeah, no, OSB is totally fine. I mean, there's no problem putting OSB down. Most of the newer homes are going to be OSB these days anyways.
You just need a quarter inch gap around the perimeter of the room for expansion and traction. So don't make it super tight.
I mean, if you had a choice, I would go with regular plywood. I think that's a better surface in OSB 21 methods, but for 18 by 18 inch tile.
And I just take a grout float.
3/4 inch floor is totally fine. As long as you're at 16 inches on center.
And embed this.
On the joist.
Now, it's not a bad idea just to do a quick test.
And I would do this regardless, no matter.
I have a little bit of.
I do it every time. You want to pay attention to see how that coverage is looking.
Just make sure that we.
And then add additional if you don't like the way it looks. But you just want to make sure that there's thin set bonded all the way across that fleece. And I just use a grout float to kind of push the air and the excess thin set.
That's better.
So you can see how that's
suctioning. You can see how it's kind of it's covered everywhere here. So it doesn't hurt to pull up each side.
And with such a small bathroom,
and just see how that
I really think
is
you
looking.
Should pull up that's all the corners, especially if you haven't done it before, and just make sure that there's going to be a good bond to it.
You just want to make sure it's well adhered. And then we'll cut around our flange over toilet here.
Yeah, Troy, I did cut out that floor vent. I did keep that register vent in there. It was on the door side, so it wasn't really
interfering.
Up against
the tub.
But I usually hate those types of vents.
You need a little bit of a expansion and contraction against that.
Yeah, rule of thumb is 1/4 inch all the way around the perimeter, even up against that tub.
We'll be addressing that waterproofing here after we get the membrane set. And then you can just simply cut out. Drywall's actually underneath there, so we don't really have to be too concerned. So just push any excess thin set that you might have globbed underneath of this. It's the same thing here. Just wipe it down with a wet sponge first. Get any dust and debris off of there.
Of course, we'll go over that carpet transition as well and how you want to address that when you install the tile. But again, burn that thin set into the substrate, and you can see how loose that thin set is. That's really important to get a good bond to the fleece of the DITRA.
Yeah.
Again, it's not a bad idea to pull that up. Make sure you have good coverage. That looks pretty good.
Not a bad idea, 21 methods. I mean, you could definitely pre-cut everything.
It comes to waterproofing.
Now, this is the important aspect. This is the way Schluter wants you to do it.
The way Schluter wants you to do this, yep. And which is a really good idea, is to use the membrane up against the tub. So we'll cut a piece of band. So we'll get a full piece from one side to the other here.
And then when you're applying...
we're going to be using Schluter Curdy Fix up against the tub. So what we do, what you want to do, is put a nice bead across the tub.
I was going to say, you want to use
don't
a
worry about getting any on the tub.
8th by 8th inch nonchalant.
So
you need a
it.
Different size trowel for the membrane.
On the Dietra mat, you want to thin set this membrane down.
So filling all those waffles and then getting directional troweling.
I want to just take this and wrap this up against the tub. So you're basically just taking a little bit of that membrane and bedding it to the tub with
the only time this is a little bit annoying and difficult is if you're using like 2x2 tiles or smaller, and you really shouldn't be using that over Dietra anyways. 2x2 inch tile is the minimum size, so you can see how that's oozing out of that tub. But when you're using normal tile, like a 12x24, that works out perfectly.
Okay,
on it, there's not really any mess that you have to get off the tub.
Waterproof this entire bathroom.
Now this is something that I just like to do. It's definitely not absolutely necessary, but hey, we're already here. I think it makes a lot of sense just to go ahead and...
A little excessive for most, but I think it's a good idea. And it's not really that expensive just to go the extra mile here.
Especially on the tub side, even if you just went to 3 feet on either side. Now you're going to have base trim, obviously, that's going to cover that. But this is a crib right next to the plumbing wall. Like, at the very least, just do that section
alone. So the
base
trim's going to cover that, but you want to just wipe off this excess thin set.
Right. Because that's going to probably be the most critical areas, right where that shower faucet is, right at that corner of the tub, so... But I like to do it all the way around the room. And I always use a 6-inch knife with a mud pan. I think it's just easier to spread. And then I take my trowel and do the trowel ridges. Especially with this loose consistency of thin set. It's a real pain in the neck to try to use your trowel and get it out of the bucket. That's where the trowel with the, you know, just using it like drywall mud, essentially. But I think this is another important area right next to the toilet. Anything ever overflowed, you know it's not going to go down the floor below. Now this part's a little redundant or dumb because I am going to be cutting out that vent. I don't actually show that in this. I think I might have forgotten about it and had to cut it out the next morning. I'm pretty sure that's what I did. Anyways, it's not a big deal. But yeah, having a floor vent does kind of ruin this whole concept to a certain extent, but... That's way on the other side of the room, so it shouldn't be a real big deal. Just make sure you wipe off that excess thing, so you don't want to have to do any more drywall work.
So in order to make this seam, you have to go over the seam with the membrane as well to make this 100% waterproof. So just get the rest of this sin set out of here.
Yeah, sure. Usually Dietra... The 3/8 inch tile will get you about 7/8 of an inch by the time you're done. Really depends on your thin set layer, but that's usually where I end up. So if you're meeting up the hardwood, I think Dietra would be better than 1/4 inch cement board. Because remember, cement board, if you install a cement board, it needs to be thin setted down just like Dietra does. That's
so
the way
if you're gonna be,
it should be done.
We're going to be installing that tile today, so you don't really have to dress anything
that didn't
with the
happen.
Waffle. But if you did have some excess thin set, you could just fill all the waffle the night before and then set the tile tomorrow.
And that's not a you know, this stent set is expensive, so you might as well use it up. And if you had like a half a bucket, you could just fill that whole waffle in. Just when you, if you do decide to do that, when you fill this,
just
wipe everything off. Just get it nice and smooth. You don't want to be leaving big globs of it or feathering over. You want to just take it and just remove all that excess, because you want to keep this floor flat. It's going to, the flatter the floor is, the easier it is to tile and prevent lippage. So, but I always, at the end of a day, if I'm not going to get into the tiling, I like to fill that waffle in so it's all pre-filled, and then all I have to do is be concerned about making sure my thin set's nicely troweled for when I lay the tile.
So that's the finished product there. But yeah, Troy, what I was going to say is if you have hardwood that you're transitioning into, Dietra would work out great, because most likely you'll be just about even, if maybe just an eighth inch higher, which isn't going to be a big deal, because most likely with hardwood, you're going to be putting one of those T-molding systems, or a T-mold between the transition, which will make it easy for your transition. But the cement board, you might be up to an inch. You might be definitely another eighth inch to 3/16 higher if you use cement board. And cement board, again, I mean, you're going to want to waterproof it. So you need the liquid waterproofing. And yeah, as I remember, your project, you were using the KBRS sealant. So maybe you have some extra of that, you can go over the cement board. So Dan, good to see you, man. Thanks for coming in. How many hours a week do I work? Oh, I've been putting way too much in lately. I'm really trying to get this course done, and you know, really, it's just that this last year has been such a change in what I initially thought. So you know, I'm running as fast as I can to get this channel moving, and I just have so much to share. I have so many bathrooms. I stopped doing bathroom remodeling at the moment because I wanted to edit all these videos. I want to make sure that I'm getting the right camera work for what I'm doing. So I really wanted to, I have four more bathrooms I need to edit. And then once I get past that, I'll take on another job. Probably a tub surround one again, or a tub scenario most likely, cause I already have four walk-in showers that I will be putting out. Two of them curbless, and one of them actually just a standard, fiberglass unit. So I think a lot of people might be interested in that if they don't want to get into all this tile work. Yeah, Troy. Yeah, the Dietra with 3/8 inch tile most likely will get you about 7/8 of an inch by the time you thin set all your tile and you actually thin set the Schluter down. But if you, as long as you get a nice loose consistency for adhering that Dietra, it should, you know, at the very most be like 3/16 of an inch height that you'll be getting additionally. So in each chapter, I go through kind of just a rough scenario of the whole thing. Again, most important thing, I'll probably highlight this, most important thing about Dietra membrane is mixing the thin set wet enough. But I just have this here so that you can not only get easy access to the links of different products that I'm using, but also just kind of give you a quick reference point before you start the project. I know, you know, you're not going to want to watch another 15-minute video before starting, so I want to make sure I highlight some of the main areas that are important. You know, I got links to the Schluter Dietra, so you can just go, you know, you can get this everywhere. You could pretty much get this at all of your big box stores and stuff, but you can also order it offline here too if you wanted to. And then the Curdy band, here I go through again about mixing half bags. I even got a link to a scale. I actually bought this thing a while ago. Now I, you know, if you're only doing one bathroom, I would not buy a scale, but this is really helpful for all types of things. You know, even grout, you can weigh, you know, a bag of grout. If you only wanted to use half of it and you want to add the right amount of water to it, so you have a good consistency, you know, put it on the scale. I really like using it. I think it makes a lot of sense to weigh your things. And then I have a link to the all set. This is what I really highly recommend. You just use the Schluter, thin set for Schluter products. It will extend the warranty. So for instance, if you use anybody else's thin set, you'll get 10 years as long as you're going within the recommendations they have. And we're going to get into that on the next chapter about thin sets. But you'll actually get the extended warranty with Schluter if you use their thin set. I believe it's 15 years. They add another 5 years if you set all the tile and do everything with their thin set. So there is a true benefit to it if you're concerned about warranties. I personally have never turned in a warranty for any waterproofing system. The only time I've ever had any type of warranty claim was actually on a Kohler tub, out of all things. The tub itself actually was defective and had a leak in it. Not from my connections, but from the actual tub itself. And then the second thing, this is over 22 years. So I really have never really turned in any of these claims. So sometimes these, you know, big warranties that they offer honestly doesn't mean anything. But, and the second thing was I had some grout that I used from Laticrete that failed. And they actually pulled everything off the market on that. And, but they did pay me to actually redo it because they knew they had a problem. So, you know, warranties are good. So, but again, I really do find that the Schluter All Set has a superior bond. I think they've done their homework on this one, because compared to other thin sets, I just don't see, the adhesion to the Dietrich mat as well as the Schluter All Set. Then I have the proper size trowel, you know, got links to that. You want to, this is really important. You want to use the right trowels. You don't want to be going with bigger size trowels and getting lumps and different things. If you use their trowels, it'll be a nice flat floor. And if a flatter the floor is, the easier it is to install. And I kind of go over references on mixing the thin set. Again, most important part is mixing that thin set properly, burning it into the substrate. These are all just highlights of that video that you just watched. I just thought this was important because if you're doing your homework beforehand and you're right before you start, hey, jump on there, get on your app, just browse through this again, make sure that you're doing things correctly. It'll make it nice and easy for you. But yeah, really, I have a couple other highlights here just to think about purchasing. I really do. No, I don't expect anybody to buy this unless you're a contractor, but I tell you what, man, these Colamix power mixers, $380 is a lot of money, but man, is that worth it? It works so well. It's definitely professional grade. So if you're a professional and you're doing, I don't even know, even if you did 5 bathrooms a year, I would buy this thing in a heartbeat. It's definitely been one of the best mixers I've had. You know, I've had a lot of things burn out, or this just has a great speed to it. I think it mixes very well. So moving on to the next stage, the thin set and tile layout. This is something that can hog up a lot of your day on the fourth day. So you have to be careful about how much time you're spending at this. You know, hopefully if it's your own home, you're able to actually go into your bathroom space in the evenings and kind of wrap your mind around it. I'm only at the home every day from, you know, pretty much 8:30 to 4 or 5, depending on how the day's going. So I only get so much time to reference, you know, this type of stuff. But if this is your own bathroom, you should be able to have some additional time to go over this tile layout, and it would save you some time. But we'll get right into that as well here. Let me see if there's anybody else in the doing here. Toya, thank you. Shields, I recognize your name from somewhere. Maybe you were on the old platform. Good to see you. And do you purchase it by the roll? Yeah, Troy, TDK, the Schluter. Yeah, I always just, you know, obviously just get what you need. I obviously get them getting the 300 square foot rolls because I do this all the time. But a 53 square foot roll would probably do your bathroom just fine. And Dominic, am I having a hard time getting materials? Yes, sir, I am. It's very, very frustrating and a little scary, to tell you the truth. And, you know, my next bathroom, I'm actually kind of mixing the systems together. That's one thing that's starting to get really irritating to me, is that Schluter only wants you to use Schluter products. Laticrete only wants you to use Laticrete products. All these companies, they don't want to mix with each other. I could only imagine if Schluter created a car and you would never be able to use any type of brakes or anything else other than their stuff, or they wouldn't warrant it. That's really frustrating to me. I don't think there's any reason for that. I understand that they are testing on their own products and they're only going to approve their own products. But you know, in this type of environment of what's going on, I think you need to start being a little bit more flexible with what you're allowed to use. So I don't see any problem using Go Board for your wall board in a shower and then using a Schluter shower pan and banding it to that. I don't really see how that could possibly be a problem, but just know that most likely your warranty will be right out the window with that. But the time savings of doing Go Board versus cement board, I mean, well, you know, there's a debate. you can just use the Schluter membrane and just go over drywall in your shower. That would probably solve the issue with the warranty and really probably save you even a couple hundred bucks doing it that way. But anyways, you know, I'm going to have a lot of videos out here that I do mix systems a lot. You know, as you can see here, I did go board and I used the Schluter membrane for the drywall seam. So there's some scenarios where, you know, if the product works great, why not use it? So, but yeah, let's get right into thin sets and the tile layout. I have a lot of great topics in this right up below here that's going to help you out. And this is really a key point, the tile setting. The thin sets are what causes the most frustration for most tile setters or DIYers. I see so many people trying to go out and buy those the buckets of mastic that's already pre-made. Some of them do say wet areas on them. I would not use that in a shower. I just, you know, again, you're relying on the warranty of that company to give you money back or pay you to redo what you put in. I don't know any tile setter that would use mastic in a shower, even if it did say that they're capable of doing it. The thin set is just the approved method by the TCNA, the Tile Council of North America, and you really don't want to go beyond that, especially as a contractor, because then you're not staying in the limits of what, you know, there's guidance is on. So stay away from the pre-mixed stuff when it comes to doing showers. You can use that stuff on backsplashes or other tiling projects, but when it comes to being in a wet area, that you have to use thin set. I think it's the best way to go, and I'm going to give you a lot of advice on that. Okay, so one of my favorite thin sets is made by Ardex X5. Really, there's one tier higher than that. That's X77. That is really premium, but it's pretty expensive. But X5 is really like my everyday thin set for wall tile. I do use it for floors as well, but floors don't take as much. There isn't as much need for a non-sag quality as you do walls. When you start setting tile on the walls, the more weight that it has, the more it wants to slide down the wall. And if you have a non-sag thin set, it'll make it a lot easier setting those tile and not having them move on you, especially if you have a mosaic. But the days of just mixing thin set to what you think is the right consistency or what it visually looks like is no longer here. You have to measure the amount of water for each thing. They really put a lot of science into this stuff anymore, and it might look thin enough for you or thick enough either way. But then once it starts to slack, which is the time period it takes to get to the true consistency, it might be thicker than you want it to be. And you can't add water later on. There's no adding water later on. The water is mixed at the beginning of the process, and that's it. You can't add it later on. So make sure you pay attention to the back of the bag. We're going to be using 6x6 smaller tile. So I'm going to be going with a looser mix. Basically, this Ardex is between 6 and 7 quarts. I'm just going to go right in the middle at 6.5 quarts per bag. And then if you want to do half bags, obviously you do it appropriately for the amount of thin set that you use. But really, you're going to get the best consistency and ability to get this mixed right if you have if you're mixing a full bag. So, you know, when you get into this, I would recommend trying to do enough tile that you're using that whole bag. All right, so let's get 6.5 quarts here.
So yeah, get a measuring bucket. RX is a little bit easier. You just actually just mix it for 2 minutes and then it's ready to go. So, I mean, you can wait for a couple minutes for the slacking.
Okay, so you can see that this is, it's a fairly thick consistency.
It'll thicken up a little bit more. That was basically right after I mixed it, so.
I would recommend just burn it into the substrate. Okay, then you want to use, we're going to be using a 1/4 inch by 1/4 inch trowel. Most of the time I set my tile with the same thickness of trowel on the smaller tiles. But this isn't always the best way to know whether you need it. I'll show you here in a minute. We'll spread this thin set first.
So make sure all your ridges are all in the same direction.
And if you're doing subway tile, I would go this direction as well, just straight up the wall. Kind of always want to go on the short side of the tile so that that air can escape.
Okay, so one way that, so these 6x6s, I would always backwater a little bit too. But just to start this out, to make sure you have the right trowel size, is just stick a piece on here and see what kind of coverage you're going to get. So that's pretty good coverage. You want to have 95%. When you see this all suctioning off like that, that means you have really good coverage. I have a little bald spot here, but basically as long as 95% of this entire area is covered in thinset, that's what you want it to look like.
Okay, so that was really, I mean, that's an important concept to pay attention to. So, but majority of the time, quarter inch by quarter inch trowel on these smaller tiles, anything less than 12 inches should just work fine. But yeah, that Ardex is probably one of my favorites. It really does last a really long time. I would say, I mean, a lot of times I'm not afraid to go to lunch with that stuff, put it that way. Yeah, I mean, I think it says on the bag 3 hours, but I've had it last 4 hours. Totally fine. Give me plenty enough time to do all my cuts and do whatever I need to do. So I'm never afraid to actually just mix a full bag of that stuff because I know I'll be using it, you know, especially the amount of tile work that I want to get on day four. So, but yeah, a lot of complaints from newbies or people that, you know, a lot of the reasons that people hate tile is thin setting. So, you know, take that away by getting something decent. That stuff is not cheap. It's definitely double the price of what you're going to get the box stores. But it's definitely going to make things a lot easier for you. So I go through a couple different things because obviously, you know, you're not going to just be doing 6x6 tile and what I'm doing in this course. So I wanted to give you some guidance on other things. So first thing is whether you get white or gray thinset. So white, almost all the videos I ever do is white, mainly because it comes up better on camera. But really, I mostly get white because just in case there's changes in the installation of what people are choosing, you can, it's always a safe bet to go with white. White will work with everything. Gray, on the other hand, you don't really want to be using gray thinset with marble, with travertine, with natural stones. Some glass may not be good, you know, it basically the gray pigment can make darken areas of natural stone and especially marble. So you kind of want to stay away from using gray thin sets for sensitive tiles that might absorb some of that pigment and make it darker. I've seen that with marble where it can look much, much darker by using a gray thin set. So that's really the biggest difference is just, you know, basically the pigment of the gray can darken things. Now, what would I buy gray for if I, you know, needed to? Gray is usually cheaper than white thin set too. So not by much, but maybe 20% less or 10, 15% less than the other stuff. But, you know, porcelain tiles, totally fine. Ceramic, totally fine. Slate, I usually like to use the gray thin set because, it's just, it's easier to, I don't know. Just like the darker tile, like slate, I do use the gray because if there's anything comes through the grout line and I'm using a gray grout, it's harder to see. But you should really have your grout joints cleaned anyways. But that's probably one scenario that I use the gray. And then, you know, really, it's just more of a cost savings things, really. I mean, using the gray or unavailable to get the white stuff. And then there's the big debate between the modified and the unmodified. And really, the big debate is primarily from Schluter. So you'll if you work with Schluter products, the orange, you know, the Dietra membranes and all that, that's where they made a big mess and a big deal out of the unmodified modified scenario. The short story is basically the unmodified is made of mostly Portland cement and sand, and so it dries. It doesn't need air to dry. So say if you had a big large 21 method, you're using 18x18 inch tile. If you use this is their scenario. This is what they believe can be a problem is that if you have a big porcelain tile, 18x18, and you use a modified thin set, that in the center of that tile, that thin set's not going to be able to dry. That because you have basically a waterproof membrane below, and then you basically have a waterproof tile over top, and there's no airflow allowing it to dry. That's basically their concept. But you will find that mass majority of all the thin set manufacturers out there will warrant their thin set being over Schluter. So it really isn't a big deal anymore. Now, why would I use unmodified versus modified? Well, as a contractor, if I was using a different type of thin set, you might want to do unmodified because it will stay in the parameters of what Schluter wants you to use. But the other reason I would use unmodified is for sensitive tiles. So that slate tile is usually, it has a rough surface. You're supposed to seal the slate before you actually install it. So that will help prevent any thin set or anything from actually getting into the crevices of the stone and absorbing into it. But unmodified thin set is going to be more forgiving and easier to clean the following day. You'll find that a lot of this modified stuff, it gets so hard in 24 hours that it's really pain in the neck to clean out. So the unmodified since it is mostly Portland cement and sand, it's an easier product to clean off the tiles. So if you have sensitive tiles, there's a couple tiles that I've installed that I could not get the thin set off of. And I really wish I would have used unmodified thin set because it would have probably came off fairly easy. So there's some of these 12 by 24 inch tiles that have like a basket weave texture to them. They're made to be like non-slip resistant, but really all it is like it's basically the ceramic or the porcelain tile is kind of etched to make that pattern. So it's all kind of porous. And when you use the modified thin set that has the polymers in it, the latex additives, it really grabs into those crevices and it's difficult to remove. Whereas the unmodified does not have the latex additive and it'll be easier to clean off the surface. So for me these days, the only reason I use unmodified is just to make it easier for the cleaning process. So I would probably use unmodified for the floor. That's probably about it. I really wouldn't use unmodified for the walls because it just doesn't have a very good non-sag quality to it. It usually is a looser. I mean, you can make it thick, but it definitely doesn't hold on to the tile quite as well as a modified thin set. So if you were to do Schluter products, I would probably just go, the unmodified would work. These are just recommendations of unmodified. And I'll probably change the order of this because I really don't want you buying unmodified thin set unless you feel that you have to keep in standards with Schluter. But basically, these are just my recommendations of unmodified thin set that would be good. So the Schluter set is really good unmodified thin set. I would probably go to that for my number one choice. Second choice would be Mapei Carabond. I've used thousands of bags of this. Great stuff. What's great about both of these products, the uncoupling membrane, I think they're the same stuff, honestly. But between the two, you can just add an additive to it and make it modified if you wanted to. So, if you had that pattern tile that you're afraid that you might not be able to get the thin set off of, you can buy a bunch of bags of this and just buy the additive to adhere the membrane and then use the unmodified for actually setting the tile. So I used to use that all the time because I just had the additive that would just add to it and it would make it modified. And really, Carabond with the additive is a really, really strong thin set. It really is good stuff. So I was really pleased with the performance when you add that additive. And then the third one would be the OG, the Laticrete. Laticrete is kind of the inventor of all of this thin set. I believe it was 1955. I had to look up those scenarios again. But they are the ones that who really created thin set mortar to begin with, especially the modified stuff. But the 317 is kind of the OG. Again, they have a latex additive you can just add to it to make modified as well. Not all my links are Amazon. Some of them are at places I order a lot of stuff. So Floor Life, that's one great place to buy grouts and everything. These guys are great. They send the stuff out really quickly. You can get all the Latticrete products in here, their grouts, all that stuff. Really nice to have an online site like this. They've been really tremendous. So this is my real recommendation of what I would use and what I've used in this shower, and that is X77 or X5. X5 is cheaper. X77 is your absolute premium. I have not found any, and you'll find it, most contractors will say this as well. I'd love to hear an opposing view to it, but I don't think there's a better thin set out there than X77. It has the best non-sag quality to it. It lasts a very, very long time as far as the pot life goes. You use it with glass mosaics. It just has a great fluffy, sticky consistency to it. So if you're doing really intricate tile work, if you're doing glass mosaics, if you're doing a waterfall feature, anything like that, X77 is definitely the way to go. You're just going to be paying a premium for it. It's going to be, you know, $60, $70 a bag. The X5 is about $30 a bag. And again, I just explained it in the video, but you basically, I use that for pretty much everything. This is really, so on this job, particular job, I bought one bag of Schluter All Set, and that was for the Ditra. And then I bought four bags of X5, and that was enough for me to do the floor and all the walls. So you're talking, what, $120, about $200 worth of thin set for a standard bathroom. My second choice would be the Schluter All Set. I've used a ton of that, and that was mainly for warranty purposes. This is still really great stuff. If you're doing, you know, even this shower, this would have been totally fine just by all set. That would have been a great. And, you know, that's the funny thing is Schluter came out with a modified thin set for their products. That's what all set is. It's modified version for them. They're just saying don't use it. Anyone else is modified. But like I said, Ardex will cover the warranty of going over Schluter products. So if you ever had an issue with a tile, deal, you can do that. And then going back to the OG, Latticrete 4XLT, great product. I would say it's not really anything different than the All Set, pretty much the same deal, but All Set and 4XLT that I'm recommending. You're not going to get a 3-hour pot life out of that. All Set these days, it really depends on humidity. So if you're in a dry, hot environment, you know, you're not going to get very long time out of any of this stuff. But typically, I get about an hour and a half to 2 hours out of All Set, and the same with 4XLT, and I get almost double that with the Ardex products. Now, you can get Ardex at, you know, it's a nationwide company, but you can get it at the tile shop. So if you have the tile shop near you, let me show you their logo. So if you have the tile shop near you, you can buy it from there. As you can see, it's $33 a bag. You know, a little pricey, definitely double what you're going to buy at big box stores. But I did want to include some big box store stuff because I know a lot of you just want to shop at those locations. I would recommend going with the Mapei brand. You know, it's a fairly decent, thin set, and, they're, you know, what, $20-$25 a bag. But any of these, they're kind of all the same. I don't really notice any difference between the ceramic, porcelain, and floor. Honestly, I think they just label them differently. I could be wrong on that, but I noticed no difference. Now, as far as getting into trials, I have a lot of recommendations on that. This is probably my go-to for large format tile, a Euro trowel. But I just kind of give you a guidance on that. Euro trowel, again, is great for 12 by 24s or bigger, 1/4 inch by 3/8, anything over 12 inches long. Again, that's going to kind of give you the same coverage as the Euro trowel. Let me just show you what the Euro trowel looks like. So you can see how it has this like weird kind of ridges. These collapse easier, but you have almost like a 1/2 inch of thin set and in a smaller amount. But just the way the pattern of the thin set goes on here allows you to really put it this way. I use this because this gives you the best flexibility for like 12 by 24s or bigger, but it also gives you the thinnest layer as possible as well. But I think having the ridges, having a big ridge and then a small ridge, it just gives you the ability to flatten out that tile or flatten out that thin set and get the flattest floor that you can. Now, if you have imperfections on your floor, if your floor is at 100% level or if there's a dip or something like that, then I would go into the half by half inch trowel, get a bigger amount of thin set there so that you have the flexibility to move it around. And then again, just referencing that you have to have good coverage and you need to check that on each tile section or each type of tile that you're using to make sure that you're getting this type of consistency. And then I just have a bunch of other recommendations that are kind of repeats, but just has it here for you. Tile light. Yeah. Okay. Here we got to go into the tile light. I forgot about this. So this is going to be referencing the first steps of the tile layout. Move this over here quick. Let me see if I have any questions here. Wow, we're already getting into an hour and a half. I might not be able to get into this next section. Troy, you're asking X5 for Schluter or for Dietra. Yeah, you can. There's no problem with that. Again, it needs to be at the loosest consistency. I would use, yeah, X5 would be okay. I would not use the X77. You're not going to want to spend that kind of money to adhere that down anyways. But I, you know, the Schluter All Set is going to be your premium deal. I would go with that. So, Danny, that's a big, long story. Danny Regay, thanks for coming here. I have a couple, I don't really have a full story on that, but basically, Jeff has kind of screwed me over, stopped paying and kicked me out of the whole system. So there might be more said on that at some point. I'm still kind of angry, or I am angry about it, but, I don't want to be, I don't want to get sued. Let's put it that way. So here's the tile layout portion here.
So quick reference on tile layout. So first off, you always want to do the back side of the shower or tub surround first. And the main reason for that is, you know, when you have your wall tile, it's better to have the back wall done first and then meeting this tile up to that, because the grout joint isn't apparent from, you know, the back side of the wall. If you were to do it this way, then you're going to be able to see your a possible inconsistent grout joint in the corner, whereas it's much tougher to see from the side. And you always want to leave a gap in between the tile and the corner. You can't just butt them straight together. You need to have room for expansion and contraction. So that's why I always recommend whatever wall that you're looking at that's on the back, do that wall first.
And that just makes it easier for
cutting. So we're going to get into doing the back side of the wall here. Now we're going to be doing 6x6 tiles. We kind of already went over what height we were going to go off of the tub. I always recommend your first row of tile. Don't just set your first row of tile and go all the way around. If you have any unevenness, you can check this with your laser just to make sure. So, you know, on this edge, you've got 3.5. And then on this side, we have, you know, almost 4 inches. So
now I do use lasers. I think ever since they really came out with some good ones, I can't remember when the real lasers really started coming out. Like I said, I've been doing this for 22 years. It had to be, I didn't start out with them. Or when I was really getting into the bathrooms. So even 14 years ago, I don't think they really, they might have had them, but they weren't quite as, I don't know, they just weren't as common, I guess you could say. But the old way used to be is that you just put a ledger board around the tub. So again, making sure that that first row of tile is not a full piece of tile, because you want to be able to scribe cut it and make it, you know, have an even joint all the way around the tub area. But you used to just stick a ledger board, like a straight edge, a piece of trim, whatever it is, screw it to the backer board, and then just put your tile on top of that and work your way up. That is totally an acceptable way. And if you've done it that way before, there's absolutely no problem using a ledger board and going up. I just find it to be more frustrating, irritating, filling in that tile down to the tub later on than to just use a laser and make sure that I cut that tile to the fit and make sure that it stays with that laser. It speeds up the process for me, because really, you know, it took me 2 days to tile everything in this bathroom, and on third day I'm grouting everything. If I had to fill that in, it might hog up more time than it's worth. But if you have, you know, if you're not in a time crunch, you know, a ledger board, there is no problem. But I still think you should have a laser. You know, there's many, many things that you can use a laser for. You know, even when you're setting your towels, bars, and accessories, your mirror, even setting the vanity. I mean, it's just a nice reference point. And especially when it comes to tile layout, it's one of those really must-have tools, because you can really reference things very easily with that and be able to predict where you're going to be bringing things. So again, you can, you can use a ledger board, but in this, you know, this is the way that I like to do it. So that's why I'm teaching it. But you want to make sure that that first tile, that there is a gap between the tub. And that's main reason for that is so that when you caulk your tub, you know, it has a good joint to actually go into. When that silicone oozes into a joint, it's going to be much stronger and last a long time. If you just smear it across the tile and smear it across the tub and the tile is tight to the tub, it'll most likely, the grout joint or the caulk joint won't last long. And that's the unfortunate thing about all bathrooms when it comes to tub and showers. That is the maintenance issue. It's the caulking. So
there's an example right there. You wouldn't want to start with a full tile on that side, and then by the time you get over here, you're going to have basically a half inch joint underneath your tub, or, you know, 3/8 of an inch. You need to be able to have the ability of scribe cutting this tile to get an even nice joint against your tub. So I always recommend taking a couple inches off. In this scenario, we're just going to go up 4 inches, and that 4 inches is going to give us basically a fairly large tile at the top of the ceiling. So we'll always kind of go over with tick marks of your layout. I just recommend just...
Now, we did reference, you know, this thought process when we're framing the corner niche. So this is the stage that I was actually thinking about that on day three. So when I was framing that niche, I was already thinking about where my tile layer is going to be. So I kind of went over the math, or kind of went over the scenario from my tub deck up. So I already kind of knew that 4 inches was gonna work. But typically that usually does work fine. Even if you're using subway tile, you know, like a 2 inch piece at the bottom usually works out pretty well in most standards, you know, height bathrooms. But there's a lot of flexibility, and we'll be going over that when we're actually setting the tile too. I have a lot of great advice, because you always want to have an exit strategy or something that will allow you to make up any mistakes. I feel like carpentry, tile work, all of that, it's about mitigating your own mistakes. I think a lot of times you're your own biggest problem sometimes, and just having exit strategies to adjust things. Because even when I'm showing you here about doing the tick marks, it's not the most accurate way to go about it. Now, you can mathematically figure it out, but it still ends up, you know, always being somewhat different than what reality is once you start setting all that tile. But, you know, I would just, you know, as long as you're going to get, you know, be able to cut off a half inch of that tile at the ceiling, you know, or just stay away from that 1 inch sliver. There's nothing worse than that 1 inch. And I've had it happen multiple times. I mean, I've had issues where I had to try to figure out a way to adjust that, because I got all the way up the wall. I'm not going to tear all my tile work down and start over. I just have to try to readjust things. So, you know, experience does matter. And these are the things I'm trying to express to you on here. But Troy, you asked a great question. Do you sometimes start from the niche down? You can. I mean, and I think in something like this, where that niche is only two tiles away, you shouldn't have a problem finding that. But what I really do, and that starts in this framing area, is that I do like to make those niches bigger than what I need them to be, so I can build up thin set for that bottom layer of that tile and make up the difference. So if you give yourself an extra inch all the way around of what you're framing, now sometimes that's not possible. In this scenario, it would have been tough to get the side framing over anymore, because I had, you know, an actual shower faucet to encounter. But the height difference, I mean, you should be able to adjust that much lower than you need and just build up additional thin set to make that work. Or you can add you can add even a piece of tile and then add it, sandwich that, you know, it's really easy to build up on the niche. It's just impossible to stretch your niche down, you know, because then you're cutting into your waterproofing and trying to adjust that tile layer. So yeah, to answer your question, no, I do always start from the bottom, but I really give a good indication of where that tile is going to end up at the bottom of that niche. So, you know, I'm doing tick marks here. That's totally acceptable, but you might want to actually, you know, put those spacers in there and get that up to your niche to make sure that that's going to work out well, and then adjust accordingly on that.
Setting your laser to where you'd like it to be, and then just run tick marks up the wall and just take a look at, see how that's going to come up to things. And, it's not going to be 100% accurate, because by the time you get your spacers in there and things, it might be, it might grow a half inch or so, but it's going to give you a good reference point of what is going to be your top tile. So this is where we're going to put our border here. So we were going to do approximately a 4-inch border. And the way that we came up with that height was that we wanted our shower rod to be directly in the center of that mosaic. So 60 inches between, so normal shower rod heights is between 58 and 62 inches. So you have wiggle room anywhere in between there, usually works pretty well. So our border, we wanted to be centered right where our curtain rod goes in. So from there, go from here, and then as you can tell, I have a fairly large piece at the top, so 5-inch piece. So that works out great. And then you have plenty of room if you had a cut, if your ceiling's not level, you have plenty of room to adjust. So you just always want to have the ability to scribe cut your tiles, I guess is mostly what I'm saying, because nothing's perfect, nothing's 100% level, and you need to account for that. Okay, so
and that's where that border, so a lot of those mosaics, and I'll explain that a little bit down in here as well. But a lot of these mosaics, you know, you can have the opportunity of making it 3 inches or 4 inches. And most of the time it's not going to really, you know, you obviously want to order enough material for your job, but typically these sheets come in 12-inch sheets. So you can make get three lengths and make it, 4-inch widths, or you can make it, get four feet worth of it out of it. So you have the flexibility of, making that border a little bit bigger, and I don't think anybody's going to notice the difference of it. So you can, you know, that's a way that you can adjust that tile layer. If for some reason you screwed up and you were going to get a sliver, you can just add that, make that a little bit bigger. And like I said, the shower rods, they're typically between 58 and 62 inches, but that really depends on your shower curtain and, you know, what you're putting on there. But that's typically 60 inches is usually like the premium spot for that, from the tub rim. That's not off the floor, that's off the tub rim.
Going from the center, if you want to check out your tick marks, just work your way over, see what will it'll look like in your corner. And this will most likely be a 5-inch piece or 5.5-inch piece, somewhere in between there.
Most 6-inch and 12-inch tiles, very, very simple.
Yeah, we got 5.25.
12 by 24
is even.
So that works
out great, because then they always do a staggered pattern. 5.25, that's less than 6 inches. So we'll probably be about 2¾ inches.
2¼.
For your other pieces on there.
I would say anything with these smaller tiles, you know, you can be... I would say really anything that's less than a bullnose size, which is 1.5 inches, that's when you might want to consider changing your layout. But in a 60 inch tub, you know, you end up with about 58 inches after, or well, 59 inches really, because it's 1/2-inch backer board on either side. You know, so when you split that right down, you start right at the center, it usually works out great, because then you end up with a 2-inch and a 5-inch piece for the 6x6s. Now that makes it easy, but then 12x12s or whatever. So usually starting in the center does always work out, you know, so, but it really depends on what you're using.
But a laser is going to really help you out. You want to be able to make sure that this first row is 100% level, and then you can easily work your way up.
So then I go into a whole bunch of more details down here, kind of, again, I really wanted to make this so that you're not watching videos after video again. Like, you know, the day that you come to this, I mean, I'm hoping that you'd be watching this stuff, you know, way previous before getting started, but just to refresh your memory of what you need to do is basically what I have highlighted here. So setting that tile on the back wall first, so when your viewpoint, you're not looking straight at it. And that, you know, you're going to be caulking all corners. So all corners, any change of plane needs to have a silicone joint. So all intents and purposes, it's going to be covered anyways, and you wouldn't see it the other way. It's just going to make it so much easier, and you don't have to be as accurate with that perimeter joint going down, because it's going to be hard to see. I mean, when you're in the shower, you can see it, obviously, but it's just going to make your tile work a lot easier if you start on that back wall. So that's where, you know, if you're doing a wainscoting going all the way around your room and stuff too, there's a lot more to configure and figure out here. But start on that back wall first. Always start with less than a full tile so that you have the ability to scribe cut things and make things even down here. Always leave like a, I just use those horseshoe shims and I use basically a 16th inch grout joint at that tub rim. That works out perfectly. Makes a nice caulk joint. So this is another reason why you wouldn't want to use a full tile here. See how I have that basically edge of the tile kind of cut around the edge of my tub. So that little detail there, you wouldn't be able to do that if you started with a full tile. You'd end up with this kind of ugly gap in that corner. So this allows you to scribe cut that and make that look nice. And that would be the same for if you had a shower receptor too. You know, you don't want to be starting out with a full tile at the bottom as well. Marking the wall up, double checking things. Again, you're most likely going to expand as you go up because their spacers are actually going to create more space than what you're marking here. But it's a good reference point and visualization when you're in the space. And then I just have this as a reference for your shower rod, 58 to 62 inches off the tub rim. I should probably put that in there off the tub rim, but I'm sure you would realize that would be way too low if it was off the floor. And then I just go over the reference point about these mosaics. This is day four as well. We'll get into this, but you want to, if you're doing a border, this is going to make it a lot easier for you. If you set this stuff up the night before, have it set on these membranes, it'll make it easier to embed. And then I have a whole bunch of stuff. So again, you know, these horseshoe shims, it's the small things that make it fun. It's the small things that make it easier. And these tile spacers, just buy, you know, you probably only need one box of these. I think these are 100 count. You can reuse them too. So they're not very much money. Just don't be using those rubber spacers from Home Depot. Those things really suck. And they're not even, a lot of them aren't even consistent, which is annoying. But majority of the time, most tub surrounds, all I'm using is a good grinder and a good diamond blade. So these STL blades are really awesome. Now I know it has a pretty hefty price tag for them, but these allow you to really cut into tile. And you'll see in the next video, which I'm probably gonna end up doing tomorrow because we're already an hour and 40 minutes in. I'll probably do the next session tomorrow, Wednesday. Probably, I don't know. Give me a comment, you guys, if the evenings are really the best time for you. You know, if watching this later, you know, if you would watch it later, or are you more interested in watching it live than to watch it later? Because sometimes it's easier for me to do this during the day, you know, and go through things, but I don't get as much interaction either. So I really want to try to make doing these live streams where I could get the most action, because that's first, it's going to help out the video. And again, hey, if you're in the chat, please give me a like. It'll help out this video get out there, and subscribe if you haven't. But these STL blades, tremendous. I'm not saying if you're only doing one bathroom, I probably wouldn't buy that. $130 is a lot to buy for a grinder blade, but it is a really great blade and makes things easy for you. You know, a cordless grinder, you don't need a cordless grinder, obviously, but these things have like a brake system on it that stop really quickly and nicely. And you can obviously use this for, you know, I would buy that, you know, this is one of those must-have tools. I'll probably come up with a list that, you know, like if you're going to do a bathroom remodel, you're going to need these tools. There's really no other way about it. But a grinder is definitely one of those tools that are really important to have. And then what else is really important in here? Tile cut. So what I was going to say, most tile installations, all I need is a good tile cutter and a diamond blade. You don't always need to have a wet saw. Wet saws, you know, I used one in this particular bathroom because I needed to cut down the shelving unit in the corner. So these quartz shelves needed to be cut, and it does make it nice to use a wet saw to, you know, for instance, like on this outside edge right here, these 3-inch tiles, it's nice to have on a wet saw and have nice clean cuts. So you can cut multiple tiles that are going to be the same size on your wet saw, and they're going to be nice and clean. So, but you don't need a wet saw. You could do this without it. And there's a lot of jobs that I don't even bring out the wet saw because there's, you know, it's just not,
it doesn't really benefit you. So a good tile cutter, the one that I liked using in these small spaces is this Mini Puma. Probably gonna have a hard time getting all of this stuff, but this guy is really sold out, so you're probably not gonna be able to get it. But it's a great little tiny one, great for small spaces, great for backsplashes for these tub surrounds. I just have it, you know, it's just really convenient. Those other tile cutters can be pretty big and enormous and take up a lot of space. So yeah, we're probably gonna leave it at this. I didn't realize it was gonna take me this long to get through this much of it, but this is a really important part of this is selecting these thin sets. This is all going to make this a fun process versus being a really frustrating one. But tomorrow or the day after, I'll try to, we'll get into this actually setting the tile on that back wall. And I have some tips for you if your thin set gets really hardened. But I have a lot of great things in here that are going to help you out as well. So let me grab myself bigger here. And then if you guys have any additional questions, let me look in here in the chat. Okay, Troy, you said evenings definitely work better. All right, well, I'll try to do evenings the best as I can. Yeah, so maybe I don't know if tomorrow works or not, but Wednesday I might. But, you know, basically I have most of the videos built out for the fourth day, and I'm going to probably start working on day five as well. And again, I'm hoping to have this course complete by the end of the month, and then I want to keep adding stuff to this as well. So let me see here. Thanks, Dominic. I hope these tips do help you out. You know, it really does come down to I've learned everything the hard way. And tile setting, a lot of that is just learning the hard way, you know, making mistakes and having to make up for them and redoing things. So I'll probably leave it at this. It's 1 hour 45 minutes. Thanks everyone for joining me. This has been the best crowd yet here. But yeah, again, you can always just go to my YouTube channel, watch these other, I'm already in the way here, but take a look at all the other live streams I have. I try to keep this under hour. Most of it doesn't really happen that way because there's always so much to explain. And, yeah, let me see if there was anybody else on here. Is your course 25 or 7 days or 25 for each day? Oh, 21 methods. It's $25. It's all it is. For right now, I mean, once I'm done with the course, I would imagine that price will triple. But I really want to just get people into it and interact. The thing about Teachable, this course that I develop on this site, there's coaching plans and stuff. So if you really need a higher level of help, I could get on a FaceTime and take a look at your bathroom and really try to help. But you know, these next couple of months, I'm just trying to get this YouTube channel growing. I've already done it before on another channel and I already know what it takes. So really helping out people the best that I can is definitely going to be the way to do it. And I'm just excited. Anybody who's in here, in this course, I will definitely be getting back to you, taking care of you, answering your questions. Because I really appreciate the feedback. And, this isn't the first course I've built, obviously. I've had in the other library, I had over 300 videos in there. So I've gotten better over time. But my hope is that, with the Teachable outline, it's going to be easier for you to access the information. And again, even at the bottom of each one of these pages, I have, I didn't even put it on that one, unfortunately. Let me shrink this down again. This is just the reference in the course that when you have a question about something, I didn't put it on all three of these. Going back to the waterproofing here, let's just go back to this. At the bottom of the page, there'll be a comment section that you can leave a comment and I can get back to you. So like that's the big thing. It's just like direct access to the person who's actually developing it, who has the experience on it. So anyways, thanks so much, guys. I'll see you in the next one. And I hope you move forward on getting your bathrooms in order. Thanks so much.